Welcome to This Jungian Life. Three good friends and Jungian analysts, Lisa Marciano, Deborah Stewart, and Joseph Lee, invite you to join them for an intimate and honest conversation that brings a psychological perspective to important issues of the day.
I'm Lisa Marciano, and I'm a Jungian analyst in Philadelphia.
I'm Joseph Lee, and I'm a Jungian analyst in Virginia Beach, Virginia.
I'm Deborah Stewart, a Jungian analyst on Cape Cod. Today, we are going to talk about splitting, polarization, and the conflict that two polarities or a split naturally induces.
Couldn't we just talk about sex or death or something light like that?
Yes, we could, but today we're talking about splitting, polarization, and conflict. And we're on to a hot topic here. And this occurs intrapsychically between me and me or you and you, which often gets overlooked when this comes up. It certainly happens in families. It happens in partnered relationships or romantic relationships between me and a you. And it certainly happens, as we're all aware, in the political realm. And so we're going to talk about it in those four contexts. We're going to talk about the role of empathy versus having a moral position, making decisions, taking action, and how feelings, values, and facts either intersect or collide or all of the above.
So I think the first plane of consideration that we can comfortably land in is the intrapsychic kind of polarization that in that realm is considered a normal process. Sometimes it's developmental. Sometimes it can be a sign of trauma. Sometimes it can remain late into life as a sign of psycho-spiritual immaturity. But if we imagine that the psyche is a landscape and that the ego is one character on the landscape and that there are clusters of memories and experiences and sensations and archetypal themes that are playing out on the inner landscape, chances are the waking personality, the ego, is at times at great odds with other things that are going on inside of us. And these inner kind of internal political campaigns or internal wars that erupt are definitely in the realm of the polarizations that we work with as analysts all the time.
And I think that happens routinely. I think anybody and all of us can easily come up with many examples of basically when the ego is in one position and other psychic factors, the unconscious or psyche, is in another position or positions. For example, the person who hates his job. And the ego says, well, darn it, you know, you have to keep doing this job until thus and such a time, or maybe if, or whatever, but you're going to get up and you're going to get in the car or on a train and you're going to go to work, whether you like it or not. And if the unconscious or other psychic factors are not listened to, empathized with, and included in the discussion, all manner of things can happen. The person can start to have stomach problems. There can be bodily reactions. There can be intense feelings of stress. There are all kinds of things. So that those two places have become polarized and now they're at war with each other.
Yes, and we think about this as a neurosis, that we have an internal split, that there are at least two different agendas going on at the same time. And I'd like to say at the outset here that we often think about polarization as there being two opposite positions. But in reality, I think most of the time there are a myriad of positions and that we tend to want to flatten it into two opposing conditions. And that doesn't help either.
I think Jung had a tendency to do that too. And
yes,
it's embedded in Hegelian philosophy. And, you know, there's a long history of this because it makes it easier for us to wrestle with two things rather than with six things.
So I think relative to taking an ego stance, a self-aware stance, one has to define oneself and one has to differentiate what the other is inside of us. And temporarily, that may be a convenient way of parsing out positions so that we have this feeling that there are two poles to the discussion. I think once that initial opening salvo, you know, is imagined and the ego and this other thing come to the mediating table, I think over time, we recognize that there are multiple other nuances to the conversation. But often we have to start with two concrete imagined places in order to differentiate anything. So I think it serves in the beginning to perhaps be overly explicit with it.
Well, and of course, one of Jung's great insights is that life proceeds according to pairs of opposites. He said something very similar to that. And he talked again and again about the need to hold the tension of the opposites. What he tells us is that we can do that rather than collapsing in favor of one or the other, that then the transcendent function will begin to operate. That is, that in the tension of the two opposites, a third thing that can't be imagined by ego will spontaneously arise as a result of that tension being held. So I think we're going to try to come back to that again and again as we have this discussion here today.
I'm really liking your differentiation idea, both of you, of that it does help us if we can wrestle the conflict into two things, a pro and a con, whatever it might be, and that then that third thing arises. And, you know, if you, whoever the you is, could think it out, it would be done already. Right. So it sounds a little bit like the magical mystery tour of, you know, should I do X or should I do Y? Should I do A or should I do Z? And then exactly how does that third thing arise? You know, does it just descend from the sky or, you know, how does it happen so that we can make it believable, possible, able to be imagined while we're holding the two opposites?
Well, we're in the realm now of the transcendent function and Jung's observation of how symbols are spontaneously generated.
Ah, a symbol.
So the transcendent function has been defined in different ways. And one of the difficulties is Jung brushes against that concept or the development of his concept many times over the course of his career and his writings. So sometimes it's hard to put your hands on what he meant at any one time. But I would say the most derivative meaning that I've come up with is that it is the outcome of the dialogue between the conscious and the unconscious mind. And that in the true spirit of a dialectic, a dialogue, that the ego has really identified the unconscious as an autonomous, vibrant intelligence, almost like another personality inside oneself, and that the ego becomes interested and inquiring, and the unconscious then becomes responsive, and this kind of talk begins to happen, and that certain kinds of psychological phenomena seem to happen out of this dialogue that doesn't seem to happen very easily without it.
And I would make some space, going back to your word symbol, for how things may start to appear as that tension gets held. Let's make up a few scenarios. You go by a bookstore and you see a book in the window that catches your eye for some reason. You go in and you read what's on the flyleaf and you go, I don't know why, but I think I'm just going to buy this book. You have a dream and maybe in the dream an animal appears, or you're in a special place that has a kind of numinous quality, or some other human figure appears. So it's not going to be the direct answer that ego would like of you should definitely do Y. That's what you should do to solve the problem. It's going to be a kind of emergence of your own interest and energy, vitality, curiosity, that somehow starts to emerge, will coalesce, and move into a new direction. Of course, we have examples from mythology and religion of the famous one of Paul on the road to Damascus, where the transcendent function appears, you know, as a bolt out of the blue. But it can also be this slower emerging as a result of a natural consequence of a dialogue between the ego and the unconscious.
And just wanting to try to nail this down a little bit further, Deb, I think I'm picking up on the spirit of what you were sharing. When we have a very consolidated, rigid stance toward a content in the unconscious that we've decided cannot be allowed, let's say that we feel that we're not allowed to get angry, for example, and then we find ourselves in a pickle because, of course, we do get angry, and then we're frustrated at ourselves for getting angry, and this can create all kinds of symptoms. One of the things that I might do working with that clinically is really encourage an acceptance of the content that has been reviled or disallowed. So an acceptance toward the other thing and a curiosity about it. I think curiosity is an antidote to polarization, that we have to get curious about that other thing.
Now, sometimes the other thing could be very easily integrated into the life in terms of being socially acceptable. Sometimes the other thing is so strange, unusual, or so unacceptable to the culture that one is left with a great mystery, feeling that, you know, you could never let that cat out of the bag and be safe. But, you know, one of the great polarizations that was present at the birth of psychoanalysis is the conscious attitude that sex should only be used for procreation. Fundamentally, it's a human evil. If we could all just transcend it and become angels, we'd all be better off. And particularly for women, that for a woman to enjoy sex in Victorian Vienna was considered unbelievably base. People were having sex with their clothes on, doing everything they could to minimize anything that seemed bestial about sex. So that's one polarized camp that the conscious attitude was developing. But somewhere in the unconscious attitude, there's a whole other campaign going on, which sounds like, we need sex. Sex is good. Sex is great. More sex, more sex. And they're carrying signs.
And Freud did have an affair with his sister-in-law, as with his wife's sister.
That's right. That other campaign obviously won.
And oftentimes, most of the time, the underdog, the unconscious, will win. It will out.
Actually, I want to say that I wish that were always quite so clear. What I would say is that the unconscious is exerting enormous influence. I don't know if it wins, but it will punish you and make your life miserable.
That's what I mean, that it will have energy and influence, and one way or the other, it's like somebody knocking on the door and you look out and you go, ooh, I'm not going to let that person in. And then the banging on the door gets a little louder. And finally, it'll kick the door in. We have to do something with that energy, or it will do something with us.
But kicking the door in can look like developing horrible pain in the pelvis.
Yes, it can.
Hysterical numbness in one of the arms, or a horrible skin disease all up and down your back. So kicking down the door doesn't really relieve the conflict. It just brings the conflict into a different realm. So maybe it goes from a nightmare into your tissue functioning or your muscle functioning or uncontrollable emotions that, you know, here and there, rage bursting onto the scene.
So I think that's exactly it, that the polarization or splitting tends to escalate. And if you don't answer the door, and the door gets kicked in and it manifests in some other, perhaps physically painful way, that is the escalation. The polarization has now become a war. The question is, what's the resolution?
Sort of how do we keep talking? How do we keep the dialogue open between ourself and herself?
And I would like to also differentiate between what we feel and what the facts of a situation may be. And really, I think mostly we're talking much, much more about feelings that ego perceives as anathema versus what we do about it, that I can't have that angry feeling or the hostile feeling, or this goes against the values I was raised with. I was raised in a particular tradition, and this is wrong, and I know it's wrong, and that sets up the conflict. So it's really about first, how do I admit that feeling into consciousness? And then what I do about it can be much more judicious and considered. You know, if I have a feeling about, for example, running away from home, that doesn't mean I have to run away from home. I don't have to concretize it, but I do have to be aware that something in me is setting up a feeling of I want to reject the situation I'm in.
So coming back to maybe a clinical example, so let's just say that there's a young woman, or perhaps a middle-aged woman, for whom sex was considered very wrong, very frightening by middle-aged. You know, she has not been sexually initiated, let's say. And then she begins to have dreams. And in the dreams, she meets a very sexually liberated, perhaps even sexually provocative internal figure dressed in, you know, very sexually alluring clothing, a kind of Aphrodite figure. And then in the beginning, the waking personality might wake up in the middle of the night gasping and feeling terrified that she's being pursued by this, you know, Jezebel of a woman marauding around. And there's a lot of defenses come in motion. So the next day, this woman might see some scantily clad women out of the office and find herself furious and really wanting to complain about them to the company, because all of those kinds of behaviors have to be deeply suppressed in order to keep all of that sexual libido constantly distanced and beaten down. Now, with the benefit of even just meditation or perhaps analytic work, the analyst or even just a good friend might normalize that dream image and say, you know, she's really just walking around in a restaurant in your dream. I mean, it's not like she's toting a machete or an Uzi. She's just kind of having a life in there. You know, is there a way in which, you know, this could actually be a much more calm internal process where you might imagine going over and just having a conversation with this person and asking her who she is? And the question I love for people to ask when they have a provocative inner figure is, what are you here to teach me? Mm-hmm. And surprisingly, these imaginal figures will come up with things that we might not have even thought that could come forward, which is, of course, coming from your inner wise self. But see, that's just the beginning of the dance. What Deb and Lisa were pointing to after that, after tolerating that initial just respectful conversation, is that over time, a new image will often show up in the dream or in the imagination, which symbolizes the union of both attitudes. That does not diminish either attitude, and yet combines it in a third way of thinking and feeling that allows both elements to survive without conflict.
Yeah, that's a lovely explanation of it.
So I'm aware that we have talked as psychoanalysts, naturally enough, about the intrapsychic process of dealing with polarization and inner conflict. And I think there's another whole dimension to this that we mentioned at the outset of what happens when there's conflict in a romantic or partnered relationship, what happens in families, and what happens in our society, our culture. Once it's out there and you have real others to deal with, it can be an entirely different matter, or at least it can feel like one.
Well, first of all, I think that often what happens is that we can tend to project our shadow material onto an other. And let's stick right now in the romantic realm. So we may project our shadow material onto our spouse. Jim Hollis often will say in his lectures, if you're not sure what your shadow is, ask your spouse. And we see this in romantic relationships, in marriages and partnerships, where one person really holds one pole and the other person holds the other pole, whatever that might be. And if we're too rigid about this, it really means that there's a whole lot that we never have to encounter or take responsibility for. Maybe just to ground it in an example, if one person always handles the finances, always handles the checkbook and the banking, and the other partner has no idea how much money comes in, how much money comes out, goes out, the partner who's handling that has consciousness, the other one gets to be very unconscious of it. And that can be a kind of polarization in and of itself.
Absolutely. And there are all kinds of other polarizations that take place in coupled relationships. Of one person is the outgoing, social, extroverted person, maybe the person that prepares all the Thanksgiving dinners and holds parties and does a nice Halloween celebration and so on. And the other person pulls for more quiet and introversion. And that together is sort of like Jack Spratt and his wife. The idea is that there's an overall balance because one person is outgoing, one person handles the money, one person is more introverted, doesn't do that. And yet we are pulled to moderate, resolve, and find a third creative way of these relationships that may not even be conflicted. It might just be taken for granted that that's the way we do things. And yet the other person is pulled to be either more introverted, more extroverted, more financially conscious, less financially controlling.
I remember once reading a couple therapists was asked, what is the definition of a healthy couple? And this person, I wish I could remember who it was, answered, a couple where people can change roles. Which I thought was a really interesting answer because I like your reference to Jack Spratt, Deb, that when we get really rigid about how we divide up attitudes or behaviors or roles, then there's a kind of stasis that happens. And when we can switch places, then we're more responsible for our own psychic material. And we're not just projecting out our stuff onto the other person. Just another quick example. At one point, my husband and I were trying to make a major decision, and I was pro and he was con, and I was irritated at him that he wouldn't go along with me. And then one day he said to me, you know, I've been thinking about it, and I think I might really actually want to do that. And suddenly I was like, wait a minute. No, I'm not so sure that I want to. Because as soon as he wasn't so rigidly holding one pole, I was forced to claim my own ambivalence. You know, I had to connect with everything that was there for me rather than just holding one side of it.
That's just a great example that oftentimes it serves us to project our shadow onto the other person. And so convenient, you know, he's wrong or she's just, out to lunch on this. Good. It's not my problem. My problem is that my partner's just plain wrong. Oh, that makes it simple.
I think another dimension of polarization that's really common in romances is along the spectrum of autonomy in general, because it's at the heart of what it means to co-create a life, that all of us have a certain part of the psyche that wants to be alone and autonomous and wants to make decisions without having to compromise. Particularly compromised with another person. And then there's another part of us that wants to lead a life that's very blended and cooperative and that we are perhaps even at the far end in a kind of divine ecstatic fusion with the beloved. So internally, we're holding a tension between how much alone, how much together. But that very much gets polarized in the relationship where one of the partners will hold this very blended value system. And they're generally the one who's constantly inviting or pulling the partners together to do things as a couple, share all the feelings, share all the dreams, coordinate all of the behaviors or many of them. And then what will be assigned to another partner is, you know, wanting to be alone, wanting to take separate vacations, wanting some other highly autonomous kind of life. And I've certainly seen in my consulting room, couples come in crisis around these two values, and that an image that could be held by both of them, where both of those qualities could be equally available to both partners, and most importantly, safely available to both of those partners, still, you know, hasn't come forward yet in their minds or in a way that's credible, and that it seems that they're just on two sides of a line firing cannon fodder at each other back and forth. And then whether or not they can even stay married, you know, is now the big question.
Yeah, it's things kind of come apart into these two, in these very split positions, and it can be difficult to reconcile.
And I think that partnership, however it's constructed, when it's committed, and these kinds of polarizations or conflicts really are calls for each person to do his or her own personal work toward wholeness, and to go there first, and then it can become a question as two people really mature and gain more self-awareness. Then you're managing differences of, I want to go here and you want to go there. I want to stay home. You want to go out. It's the heat has turned way, way down of, okay, you can do something separately. It's not that big a deal anymore. It's a big deal when it's infused with our own unconscious projections and shadow and all the rest of it, most of the time.
And it becomes a problem when the tension moves into more and more extreme levels. It's the movement to extremity, whether that's in the psychological realm, or whether that's the political realm or the familial realm. But when things become extreme, then the costs get really high. It's funny, I'm thinking about a really funny example. I'm sure we all watched I Love Lucy. I'm in that generation. But there was this one episode where Lucy's really, really pissed at Ricky, and then she draws a line down the center of the apartment that he's not allowed to cross. And it goes up on the ceiling, it's down on the floor. Like every room is divided in half, and, you know, he's not allowed to cross. So you talk about kind of escalating the polarization. And then, of course, it can be humorous, but a lot of times it's not so humorous.
Well, and that's a great point, Joseph. And I think that one thing that happens with these extremities that you're referring to is one extreme constellates the other extreme. So when someone takes a very extreme position, we often feel pushed, unconsciously even, to adopt the opposite position, sort of like what happened with me and my husband when we were trying to make that decision, is that there was no room for me to inhabit or be in touch even with all of the nuance around the issue for me, because I felt compelled to hold the other extreme from him.
Yeah, it's moving from sort of a seesaw image that if this thing is going to work, you know, I have to go down when you go up, and I'll go up when you go down. Because if I just get off the seesaw, the whole thing will fall apart.
And there's no movement then. And there is a dynamic tension, right, in the opposites. I mean, that's what kind of part of Jung's conceptualization of libido is, that it arises out of the tension of the opposites. So we don't want everything to necessarily be harmonious all the time, but we do certainly need to figure out how to manage these tensions and these conflicts. Otherwise, I think humanity itself is imperiled if we can't.
I think when I was quite young and I was in my first personal experience of being in therapy, and I didn't really have very many relationship tools at all, I found myself, you know, really in a lot of tumult with my lover at the time. And this really wonderful, wise woman, she said, you know, the thing that's happening is that you haven't learned how to verbalize very clearly what you want. Let that just pause there without trying to convince anyone. And then the second half would be to ask the other person, just what do they think about what you've said? And to let go of any of the cajoling or pressuring or intensity, which is really actually very hard for people to do, to sit there on a Saturday and ask myself, well, what do I want? I really want to go out for pizza, and then I want to go out to see thus and such of a movie. To be able to state what you want, and then sit there and go, what do you think about that? And then just shut up. Which is a way of actually being your own person, because I think polarization at its core has something to do with being self-defined, mm-hmm. or reaching for self-definition, even if it's something you're absorbing from a group. But you're trying to say, I am this and not that.
Right. Sometimes we define ourselves in contradistinction to what someone else is doing or saying, right? And that's part of how this gets going, mm-hmm. is we need to be the opposite of whatever that other person is or that other group is.
That goes into this idea of social reaction theory, that because we have an impulse to be our own person, to be an individual, we then look at what seems to be collective, and we decide we're going to do something that's not collective.
Which, of course, is collective.
It's the story of adolescence.
Yes.
You know, everybody's wearing preppy t-shirts, and I decide that I'm going to be one of the four goth kids, right. You know, in the school. Although it's not anything I ever really aspired to be, but it's a big thumb in the eye of, you know, everybody else's sense of norms. So that's one thing. But I think there's a deeper, more mature polarization, which is I'm introspecting. I really do have a sense in a given moment of what I believe I want to pursue, have, experience. And I introduce that into the relationship, whether it's a family, a work site, or a love relationship. And this is where the art comes in. Can I introduce it and then have a dialogue about what's emerging inside of me, what has libido inside of me? So we've tossed around a couple of different attitudes, but you know, I'd like to suggest that we, you know, jump right into the boiling
deep end of the
hot
pool.
Tub, yeah, and talk about this in the political sphere, because my goodness, we are seeing that in spades right now. Perhaps for me, again, I'm 57. I feel like this is the hottest political polarization in my personal memory, and creates enormous amounts of feelings in me and in many other people. And how do we approach this psychologically?
Yeah, and I want to start off with this amazing thing that Jung said that's in Barbara Hanna's biography of him. He was asked, did he think that there will be a nuclear war? And he answered, it depends on how many of us can manage to hold the tension of opposites. Eric Neumann, a Jungian analyst and a colleague of Jung's, who was Jewish and after World War II migrated to Israel, he wrote a very important book called Depth Psychology and the New Ethic. And essentially what he says is, given the way the world is today, we can no longer afford to deal with conflict by projecting it out on the other and then dealing with it as if it belongs to someone out there. We must do our own inner work and find our own capacity for evil. And that this is the basis upon which we need to deal with mass movements, for example.
That sets up a real feeling in me, because we all have, I think, very strongly held values about all kinds of things, politically, familial values, religious values, and we want to be in harmony with and see a world that has space for us with our values and reflects that identity and value, all the values back to us. And so it's very intense when a strongly held value comes back at us in as an equal and opposite reaction and feels intolerable. And I think the call is not to feel warm and fuzzy and friendly toward an opposing value. There are values that I oppose, but I want to differentiate between that and the person who is speaking, that person is not necessarily, you know, wrong, bad, evil, etc. So that you can come to your own grounded stance and decision that ego has made more thoughtfully than just a reactive, heated polarization.
And I think that when these excessive passions become activated, whether it's a purely internal environment or whether it's a political environment, we know that we're in the realm of a complex. Because Jung's first experiments with the word association tests were that he would read a list of fairly innocuous words, pond, house, dog, tree, etc. And what he would notice through a kind of intricate observation is that some just single words would disrupt people's ability to think clearly or even just clearly describe what's going on around the word. So what it tells us is that there are these limbic system reactions that then cloud the ego's ability to really think through what's in front of them in a temperate way. And we're seeing that in this political polarization. I mean, it sounds like a simple solution, but it's not. If Americans were permitted to simply take each idea that's being presented and analyze each idea on its own merits and have that separated out from political parties or whether it's being said in a way that's appealing or not appealing or which news commentator tells you you should like it. Actually, there was a thoughtful differentiation and analysis of a discrete idea so that each person could then collect a basket of what they find valuable or not valuable, concept by concept, I think that that would take a lot of heat out of the debates and introduce a much more thinking component.
Yeah, I think that's a really interesting idea. And it takes me back to an idea that we floated a little bit earlier, which is the importance of curiosity. I mean, any one of these ideas that get people so hot under the collar actually are often pretty complex. And if we could be curious about the different stances around, for example, abortion, we might find ourselves rethinking of it or at least understanding that it's complicated. But, you know, Joseph, I want to bring in something here from social psychology in relation to what you've just said. It's pretty well established now that the way we function, all of us, is we have an emotional reaction to something first, an unconscious emotional reaction, and then we use our thinking function to come online and create rationales for why we believe that. So we all think that we have rational reasons for why we believe things, but social psychology has demonstrated pretty clearly that that's just not true. That for all of us, we have emotional reactions first, and then we justify those ex post facto with arguments and
narratives. And there's also, I'll bring in biology, that there is biological evidence with fMRIs and so on, that people people's brains are different, and that certain areas of the brain light up more in people who have a strongly individual stance, being individually self-sufficient, responsible, etc., versus people who have a more sort of communally oriented value system. And that's an altogether different area of the brain that lights up doing some of these tests. So we may be wired differently as well to tilt toward the common good, the good for all, social service programs, for example, versus, you know, come on, find your bootstraps, pull yourself up, get yourself in gear and figure out a life.
Well, there's a very nuanced and interesting exploration of a lot of these issues in a book called The Righteous Mind by Jonathan Haidt. And he talks about the differences in moral reasoning between people who tend to be liberal and people who tend to be conservative. And it has to do with the relative importance of different kinds of moral values.
I will add another book, and these will all be in the show notes, of course, that I believe is entitled American Nation. I read it some time ago. And what it talks about is in all of North America, there are, he identifies, 11 nations, different cultures with different values, sort of New England, communal, the commons, kinds of values around education and community togetherness versus people that grew up and established cultural norms in other parts of the country, like he calls the borderland, which more independent, more individualistic, if I'm remembering all this accurately. But it just goes to illustrate the point of how deep essential differences go culturally, biologically, from a social science point of view. There are a lot of hardwired and enculturated differences.
And I would say that the danger is that we might take our shadow stuff and unconsciously project it on someone who's wired differently or someone who's from a different culture or has a different value base than we do. And again, the antidote to that, I think, is to be curious. You know, we don't like what someone else believes, but perhaps we could encourage ourselves to be curious about why they might believe that.
I think that there's an additional dimension around this, which gets things hot, is it's not just a cauldron of ideas. It's methods of mobilizing the ideas that we're really in a political war about. So for instance, If a group in power decides that the culture should be shaped in a particular direction, hold a particular value, which is in this world realm of social engineering, and you can't avoid the topic of social engineering without and still talk about politics, because laws shape culture, or at least attempt to shape culture. So, for instance, if we go back to the idea of abortion, and we have two groups of people, and one group says abortion should not be interfered with as a woman's right to have a medical procedure if it's characterized that way. Another group decides that abortion should never be permitted, you know, for all the reasons that they think that is the case. So we start with a kind of ideologic position. The next stage, which I think becomes the really difficult place, is how does each side want to implement the social engineering of the other side? And some of this could be much more successfully informed by psychological research and even about behavioralism. So, for instance, based on just parenting studies, if you have a child that's doing a behavior that you don't approve of, should you hit them repeatedly? Should you throw them into a room without dinner for 4 nights in order to impress upon them that this behavior is incorrect? Or do you actually refuse to respond to the negative behavior and offer them much more appealing options, and reward them highly for pursuing options that you believe would actually produce a better rounded child on your behalf. And research suggests over and over again that trying to dissuade behavior through violence of one form or another is a terrible way to shape the culture of the child. So let's come down now into something as provocative, especially in light of this recent Alabama ruling about abortion and doctors being jailed for, you know, years for giving an abortion. If, let's say, a community decided we want to really reshape the culture's attitude about abortion, if all of that money and energy were put into creating incredibly warm and welcoming alternatives to abortion, if any young woman felt that there was a loving, holding environment that she could go to, that she would be supported, she might even have to live there in order to bring forth a child, which then would be put up very responsibly and caringly up for adoption, and that the girl's value was affirmed, that the parents and the family and the community were supported, and that there was no sense of threat or violence around all of that.
Or stigma.
That would be a much more psychologically informed way of shaping the culture relative to whether or not abortions then seem even necessary to have.
I think that's, I love that point, Joseph, because I actually think abortion is a great kind of case study of polarization in America, in the United States, because I think there's huge, huge, vast tracts of common ground that have been unexplored and unexploited as both sides have taken fairly extreme positions. And, you know, I know what I think about this, and I'm actually not going to share it, but I can use my empathic imagination to understand what either side might feel about this. And there certainly are arguments for both extremes that I could feel my way into. But even if we leave aside the extremes, Joseph, I think what you're lifting up is, you know, I think we could all agree that it's, or most of us could agree that it's not an ideal outcome. It would be good if there were other possibilities. But we have lost the ability to even have that conversation because it's become so polarized that it's like that silly example of me and my husband before, we're both on separate mountaintops shouting at each other across the valley.
I like your phrase of empathic imagination of what would that change across the country around the abortion issue, around the political divide. What if we could actually talk to one another, coupling it with your emphasis on curiosity as well? But I would at least like to give you a real hearing. And I have a feeling that although I think the divide between individualists and communalists, if I can put it that way, is a very deep one, that if we could encounter one another meaningfully, imaginally, empathically, and with curiosity, it would go a long way to healing the split.
Well, and I want to come back to what I was saying a moment ago, because I don't know that it was clear, is I'm not even evaluating whether or not one idea is better than the other, because I don't know that we're really fighting about ideas. We're fighting about implementation. So whether or not we think it's virtuous that nobody should suffer poverty, let's say we decide that's a virtue. If that virtue is then implemented in a way that is punishing, frightening, and draconian, then the methodology around resolving the poverty becomes traumatizing. And then people can't even consider whether or not resolution of poverty is a virtue, because the response or the medicine to the social problem is kind of awful to people. So we're not spending enough time looking at what are ways that we can intervene with the body politic, with the citizenry, in such a way that the outcome will allow people to have more freedom, not less freedom, that people will not feel attacked or not literally be attacked physically or in other ways as people are trying to shape the environment based on what they consider virtuous. It's the weaponization and violence that is mixed into the implementation of what people think is a virtue that has ever been the ill of human society, whether we're talking about the Inquisition of the Catholic Church, harnessed by this vision of Christ's kingdom on earth, and I'm going to torture people and disembowel them as part of the Inquisition just to make sure that Christ's, you know, glorious world lands. What a horrible methodology. You know, I'm being ridiculously abstract about how I'm saying it, but
you're making the point.
Yes, how we implement things is really the issue. So if people want to reform Obamacare and make it more efficient, well, so be it. Do it in a way that's brilliant and thoughtful. Simply collapsing the entire system and leaving, whatever is it, 40% of people in Kentucky that rely on Obamacare with no insurance. And once again, in this floating mess where people are leaving change jars at the 7-Eleven to try to fund a liver transplant. There are ways that things are being changed that are so decisively punishing. And when I listen to the rhetoric about what people are complaining about, it's the punishing aggression in the delivery of the change that some people are cheering on and some people are fighting against, secondary to whether or not we're talking about virtue. And that's not being discussed enough.
Well, you know, I think you've really gotten this well condensed into a really wonderful kind of polarity for me, of that maybe the choice here is to be concrete and power-oriented and punishing versus curious, empathic, and loving. And I think that's a choice that most everyone would like to see land on the empathic, curious, and loving side.
Yeah, and I want to finish up maybe by just pointing out again that part of our work is always to be curious about where the opposite is in us. You know, Jung said, nobody is immune to a nationwide evil unless he is unshakably convinced of the danger of his own character being tainted by the same evil.
Okay, let us now move on to a dream.
Hi, this is Deb from this Jungian Life podcast. Joseph, Lisa, and I have been deeply moved by your response to our work, but producing, editing, and distributing it involves substantial expenses, and now we need your help. Please stop by our website, thisjungianlife.com, and click on the heading, Be Our Patron. You'll be redirected to our Patreon funding page. Patreon helps creators connect with people who believe in projects like ours. There, you can sign up with your credit card to support us for as little as a dollar a month. And at higher levels of support, we'll provide special episodes, behind-the-scenes photos and stories, and a chance to join a select pool of listeners for dream interpretations. Once again, please go to thisjungianlife.com and click on Be Our Patron. Thank you.
So here's the dream. A 56-year-old female who works in media shares this dream. I'm going for a holiday to Bali with my husband and best friend. We are running late for our flight. At the airport, I check in my huge suitcase and then I realize I don't have my passport. A young man with dark hair, whom I know to be a playwright, says, "Go to the counter. You look young, like a six-year-old. Act innocent. You should be able to talk your way onto the plane without a passport." But I don't want to do this. Instead, I get in the car with my husband and friend. They're pissed at me. I know it is impossible to get back home to get my passport and make the flight. Part of me doesn't really care. I don't want to go to Bali. I feel busy and overwhelmed in my working life, so I want to stay and attend to things. And I don't like the tourist culture in Bali. It's infantilizing. Still, I feel pulled in all directions. I've let down my companions. We stop by the side of the road to talk about it alongside an oil refinery. And I say, "Oh, they've already boarded our luggage, so they're not going to take off without us." Still, it's not clear what we should do from there. She offers a bit of context. "My mother is dying, probably only a week to go. My work this year has been overwhelming." In the dream, she says she feels anxious and overwhelmed. And then she adds, "Generally, her relationship with her husband and friend are close and harmonious, but in the dream, it feels fractured." So one thing I just want to say is, this is the kind of dream that people could have this experience in real life. When there is a great conflict between the ego's attitude, you know, it's driven, it's going to take this vacation with the husband and the friend, but the unconscious is really thwarting it. One of the things that the unconscious can easily make us do is forget things. It'll just pull the idea of the passport out of our conscious awareness. It'll cause us to dally. All of a sudden, it seems really important to clean the bathroom before we leave for the airport. And lo and behold, we've missed our flight. You know, what is this force that kind of reaches up and grabs us and reorients our priorities or makes us forget things? And that's the other, the unconscious in us, which, you know, is not feeling all on board with the trip to Bali.
Yeah, no pun intended. Yes.
There's, you know, the theme here of leaving, of that in the dream of leaving for Bali, and in real life, her mother is leaving, and she is leaving her mother, which is a very hard leave-taking.
And so here's the backward glance, in a way.
In the dream, she's not able to notice or acknowledge that her mother is dying, which is interesting. I mean, that's in the context.
Mm-hmm.
But I wonder if it's somehow secretly present in the dream somewhere.
Yes, yeah. That if you knew your mother were dying, you wouldn't go on vacation to Bali. I'm struck by the dark-haired young man who's a playwright, which is interesting. So a play is sort of often a big life theme. And so here is the author of the life theme, perhaps, who says, "Go to the counter, you look young like a six-year-old," which of course is absurd because this woman is in her 50s. So she doesn't look anything like a six-year-old, we can assume. But he exhorts her to act innocent. You know, she kind of maybe gives this some thought. She says, "Well, I don't want to do this." And she does say later that she finds the tourist culture in Bali infantilizing. So there's something here where she feels perhaps as though maybe one of her traditional life strategies has been to revert to a childish way of moving through the world. And she no longer wants to do that.
I was thinking about the playwright's advice and the trip to Bali both as different ways of taking flight. You can get on a plane and fly away to the other side of the world. And you can also take flight from adulthood. And I've forgotten my passport and I've screwed things up by going, oh, you know, I'm just a little kid. I'm 6 years old and I can fool people.
Mm-hmm.
Just take flight out of the conflict.
There's a little Puella feeling there, isn't mm-hmm. there?
And in the dream, things feel fractured. In real life, I'm sure it feels fracturing to be losing one's mother. But it seems like the end of the dream says, you're grounded. You're grounded. You're stuck yeah. here. You're not going to go back and get your passport and make your flight. It ain't happening.
Well, there's no lysis, though, because the plane is not going to take off without them. Or is it? I mean, it's like there's no way I'm going to make the flight, but then at the same time, it's not going to take off without us. So there is this real sense we're not sure what to do, but she doesn't want to just try to take flight, is what I'm hearing in this dream.
Right, or at least something in the unconscious is just not going to allow her to do it. The last statement at the end of the dream, we always have to be suspicious of the ego's interpretation of things. The truth is that planes absolutely will leave.
Yeah.
If your luggage is loaded and you walk out of the, you know, the airport, that plane's going in real life, and I'm sure in the inner life. So just because your luggage is on a plane doesn't mean you're going to thwart the entire trip, although she is having that fantasy that her, what I would say, passive-aggressive behavior, frankly, is actually going to freeze up the whole plane, going to stop it from taking off there at the end because she decided to leave the airport to get her passport. So there's a negative inflation. But I think what's more pointing to the beginning of Elysis is that she stops along the side of the road alongside an oil refinery.
Mm-hmm.
So when we're in this world of oil refinery, you know, it evokes the alchemical laboratory and the refinement of substances. You know, oil comes out of the ground and it's got all kinds of components in it, you know, sulfurs and plant material and all kinds of things. And all of that stuff has to be sorted out. And the different products that come from crude oil actually can be portioned out to be very valuable in different realms. But there's various refinements of the product, gasoline being one of the most refined, which then becomes an energy source. It becomes fuel for the plane to take off, for her life to take off. But at the refinery stage, it's a lot of heat and smoke, and it's, you know, smells sulfurous. If any of you have been on the New Jersey Turnpike, you know, it's not a pleasant process, but it's intense. So the dream maker plops her, you know, next to a refining process because she needs to go through a refining process of some kind before she then would have the fuel to take whatever the trip is that she's destined to take.
Yeah, I think that's a great point. And I'm aware that she uses the word overwhelmed or overwhelming three times in this. And so that really does point to the need for a refinement process. I think, especially as you explained so eloquently, Joseph, part of refining means discerning, putting things in different piles. This is valuable, this is less valuable. Sorting things out, it needs to happen here about what is the higher priority, because in this dream, it's sort of not clear what the priority is. Is it a priority to go to Bali? Is it a priority to save the luggage? Is it a priority to deal with this situation honestly? I'm also aware that what the likely lysis, which you refer to, Joseph, is that they'll take the luggage off the plane and the plane will take off without her. And the possible sunk cost here is the luggage. She might lose the luggage. Or
her baggage.
Mm-hmm, her baggage.
That's what's taking off is her baggage.
Then what's likely will happen actually is the baggage will take the trip without her.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to wind up showing up in an airport in Bali. No one will claim it. And then it'll go through all that rigmarole to figure out it's got to get sent back to wherever she lives.
But what I'm thinking about is we often talk very colloquially about, you know, well, you know, so-and-so was carrying baggage, or, you know, I was carrying baggage, meaning, you know, our own unprocessed stuff that we drag, psychic stuff that we drag around with us. And so I'm kind of thinking about, so she... her baggage takes off for Bali. And what does that mean psychically? Does some part of her take off in the plane? Are those, you know, complexes or feelings, or, you know, what's the baggage, metaphorically speaking?
And that Bali is the place, at least in the ego's estimation, it's the place of regression. That if she goes to Bali, she'll be infantilized. She has to pretend that she's a child in order to get in without proper documentation. I think that in the face of her mother's dying, there is an invitation in all of us, by the way, to regress, to feel like we are abandoned children, that we're helpless, that we're, you know, we're a baby and mommy is leaving and we're bereft, and, you know, all of those deep, deep, old foundational feelings. And that the ego, you know, is resistant to having a regression. Now, I might say that the dream maker has set up the opportunity to have a regression, a trip, a nostalgic retrospective trip back into the early childhood, and that the ego is resistant to that. It is possible that she does need that, and that the inner travel agent, which we might say is the self, kind of booked this regressive trip for her, because it's going to happen sooner or later, as it does with all of us that lose a parent. So all she's really done is delayed the trip.
The self has also parked her next to the oil refinery, which may be the telos here of the dream, that these crude contents, foundational, instinctual, emotional contents, will be refined.
I'm also aware, though, that she's willing to risk the wrath of her friend and her husband and say, this usually feels harmonious, but they're pissed at me. But part of me doesn't really care because I don't want to go. So it could be that, you know, with the looming death of this parent there as context for this, there's moving out of a more regressed way into a way of moving through the world where she's taking more responsibility for what she really wants.
Well, it'll be interesting if we hear back from the dreamer over the next few months, you know, what her trajectory takes her on.
You've been listening to This Jungian Life. From our website, thisjungianlife.com, you can follow us on Twitter, like us on Facebook, help us produce future episodes by funding us through Patreon, and submit your dreams for possible interpretation on another episode. We'd like to thank our listener who shared a dream for today's show and hope you'll let us know what topics you'd enjoy hearing more about. Until next time, keep living this Jungian life.